Welcome to the fourth session in the webinar series, Care of Diverse Elders and Their Families in Primary Care, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Chris Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the programs on falls, gaits, and balance disorders in older adults. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write your questions. The presenters will respond to the questions in a Q&A session at the end of the presentation. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. And now a little bio on our presenters. Dr. Arvind Modawal is a board-certified geriatrician and professor of clinical family and community medicine at the University of Cincinnati College of Medicine. He is currently working as a hospitalist at Westchester Hospital in Ohio and also provides patient care in skilled nursing facilities and assisted living facilities. He is associate director of University of Cincinnati Reynolds Physician Training Center for Geriatrics. He has been in clinical practice for many years, practicing consultative geriatric medicine, palliative care, and primary care in many outpatient and inpatient settings. He is an alumnus of Harvard University and obtained a master's degree in clinical effectiveness from Harvard University School of Public Health in 1999. He is on the board of Ohio Medical Directors Association and past president of Ohio Geriatrics. He has research and academic interest in falls and balance disorders, chronic complex disease management in the elderly, dementia care, geriatric assessments, palliative care, pain management, quality improvement, and health informatics. He is active in direct patient care, education, research, and administration. Ms. Rochelle McLaughlin earned a Master of Science in Occupational Therapy from San Jose State University. Her clinical specialty is in the area of traumatic brain injury, stroke, and cognitive impairment, as well as working with the geriatric population in a variety of settings, including Stanford Hospital's community fall prevention program called Feral to Falls, where she has developed a mindfulness in fall prevention component to the program. Rochelle is a faculty member of the Occupational Therapy Department at SJSU, where she developed and taught the Occupational Therapy and Geriatric Practice course, and more recently, the Mindfulness-Based Occupational Therapy course. Rochelle has completed advanced studies in humanistic psychology and is a certified yoga instructor. Rochelle teaches mindfulness-based occupational therapy at the Bay Area Pain and Wellness Center in Los Gatos. She is a co-author of the Adjustment to Disability chapter in UMFRED's latest edition of the Neurological Rehabilitation textbook. She is an author of numerous other publications and is doing extensive research in the area of mindfulness and occupational therapy. And now for the presentation.
Can everybody hear me? Okay, is it better now? Okay, thank you. Oh, thank you. So I was just thanking the Stanford Geriatric Education Center and the sponsors and my colleagues here at University of Cincinnati College of Medicine and the Reynolds Foundation for their generous support carry on the educational initiatives here at University of Cincinnati. So starting with the falls, and it's hard to talk about falls without talking about gait and balance disorders. And what we'll do is we have two parts of the presentation. and I'll cover certain aspects of this huge topic, which is a major syndrome in the elderly and also a major public health problem. And my co-presenter, Rochelle, is going to cover rest of the aspects. Since the topic is so large, in the time we have, we'll give you a little overview of the problem and things, you know, one can do in the practice, sharing of some pearls. I would also encourage the participants to actually look at all the handouts and the other materials and resources available to us in handling this major issue in the geriatric population. So I'll start off with defining fall, as we see in Angiotrix, which is, this is one definition of it, in terms of anyone inadvertently coming to rest on the ground or a lower level in the absence of trauma and other overwhelming medical event, stroke, syncope, and the key thing is that there shouldn't be any loss of consciousness. So we need to have that absence of loss of consciousness. If somebody has prior to the fall, then we have to think of other medical events. And there are various variations of this definition in the literature. For example, in nursing homes and hospital, person resting on the ground or found on the ground on the floor is also considered to have fallen. So that's the working definition of a typical geriatric fall. Just the usual statistics, and the whole literature is full of this, but just to share you with you some of the enormity of the problem on our hands. This is the data from the Center for Disease Control and from the Geriatrics Review Syllabus, Series 7, Edition 7. We have 5.8 million U.S. adults over the age of 65 who reported a fall in the previous month, and also one-third in the previous year. The problem is huge in nursing home, where we have 1.6 falls per bed per year. So any nursing home with 100 beds can easily have 160 or more falls in a year. Most of the fall are really resulting in no injury, but there are 10 to 15% of falls with result in fractures and about 5% in serious trauma, including head injury. In fact, according to the most recent data from CDC, we are seeing less of hip fractures but more of the head injuries. So that's also is a major issue when it comes to the cost and the management of these injuries. According to data which is about 10 years old, we spend in the United States about $19 billion or more in direct costs related to the falls and the services and therapies. And it does not include all the indirect costs related to hip fractures and head injuries. It's also a leading cause of injury and deaths for over 65 years of age. 80% of all fractures in over 65 are as a result of falls. About 340,000 hospital admissions are occurring for hip fractures, and this is the data from the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons. Majority of falls are happening at home, though there are falls in outdoor places, including public places, and 10% in institutions. From the nursing home data, about 10 to 25% of the nursing home falls result in ER visits and hospital care. And this slide talks about, shows you about nursing home falls. As I mentioned, it's 2 to 3 times greater than in the community. And one of the studies, which are at the bottom of the slide, have shown that history of falls in the last 6 months is a risk factor for future falls. And this has also been accepted as a standard of care in terms of the echo guidelines that one should be asking about history of falls when we are having encounters, visits with older patients. It's a major liability concern, and it requires a very organized, system-based approach to preventing and reducing falls. In terms of the causes of falls, as you may know, that it's a multifactorial problem. Often there is no single cause for falls, no single factor. In fact, many times no single cause is identified after a fall occurs. But as kind of in a general way, if one has to look at the falls, one has to divide as those which are related to the intrinsic medical factors where physicians and health professionals can do something about it, and which include some of the age-related factors. Then the one of the causes are due to medications, alcohol use, and over-the-counter products, and I'll touch on that. And then one-third, the remaining one-third are due to environmental factors, which will be covered by my co-presenter, Rochelle McLaughlin, in terms of doing a home safety assessment and looking at the environmental factors, which are really kind of a major problem. So these are the ways to look at some of these causes for falls. So moving on to the intrinsic risk factors for fall, there are many, and they are just to name a few. Increasing age itself is a problem, history of falls, female gender, medical illnesses, peripheral neuropathy, dizziness, orthostatic hypotension, cognitive impairment, visual impairment, decreased muscle strength, abnormal gait and mobility, incontinence, depression, foot problems, hearing impairment, arthritis, diabetes, pain, and the list keeps growing every day, and we're finding causes like sleep disorders also relate to falls. So it's a challenge as a clinician to really, when you are presented with a list like this, as to where should one start, and hopefully by the end of this presentation you'll have some idea of a clinical approach which may be helpful in your setting. So these are the extrinsic risk factors, and that's the medications, the over-the-counter products, and some of the iatrogenic factors. When we talk of the older population, we really are concerned about anticholinergic side effects of medications, and we have a lot of central nervous system acting medications which have anticholinergic side effects. So we really are talking about, and if we have four or five, and often in nursing home patients are taking 10 to 15 medications, and if each one of them has a small anticholinergic activity, it all adds up. So we are talking about a total anticholinergic load which has been shown to increase the risk for falls. And there are many medications, not only the medications acting on the central or peripheral nervous system, many of the cardiovascular medications, including antihypertensive, digoxin nitrates, antiarrhythmics, have been shown to be associated with falls. And similarly, alcohol and many of the over-the-counter products. This one study which sort of highlights the problem of increase in falls with the use of these medications. If you look at these slides, you have benzodiazepines and anticonvulsants which have been shown to increase the risk. But the worrying thing is the biggest increase of risk is with some of the so-called safer CNS-acting agents like SSRIs, the antidepressants, which have been, in this study at least, been shown to be more harmful than some of the other so-called medications known for their side effects. narcotics, if used safely and correctly and properly, have not emerged as a major problem in the false literature. But caution is advised. So just a little word about medications. Interesting factors I'll leave to my co-presenter, but these are self-explanatory. The indoor hazards which need to be fixed, and of course the outdoor hazards, the lighting, the shoes, the fixtures in the height of chair and bed, all those are very important consideration. Assistive living devices may help elderly person, may be a cause of falls as well. So a relevant clinical approach is not what disease caused the problem based on one disease or diagnosis model. One cannot say whether it's this condition which caused the fall and devote our energies to investigation. It may be important, but it may not give us the answer. The relevant approach is what combination of physiological changes, impairments, and diseases are contributing to the patient's risk for falls, and which ones can be modified on an individual level or on a population-based approach. So we are moving towards an individualized approach, multifactorial, multi-component assessment and intervention model, and these have also been recommendation of the new clinical practice guidelines coming from American Geriatric Society and British Geriatric Society. So assessment of a fall, basically a good history. As you know, in real estate, is history. I think similar thing, location. And here in falls, we have history. And history of falls in the last 6 months is really gives us some information as to the patient's risk for future falls. And the next one is walking the patient. You know, if you've not done these two things, getting a feel of what happened, the circumstances of fall, and if you've not walked the patient to see the gait and balance, then the interventions cannot be proper interventions cannot be put in place. So approach needs to be based on these factors. And this is a mnemonic for those who like mnemonics, is what happened, whether history or previous falls, what were the person doing, what was the light and local conditions, the time of the day, and whether there's an injury. Injury assessment or fall is really is the first thing before one starts to understand the causes of falls and do something about them. So I just want to introduce you, if you're not aware, of four very simple tests, you know, which you can incorporate in your practice. There are many other tools available to us, like a Berg balance test or Tinnitus performance oriented mobility assessment test, which are pretty detailed and exhaustive and certainly are a great tool for research purposes. But in clinical practice, where you have very little time for assessment, these simple tests really give you a lot of valuable information. And what happens is we are falling because with their age-related changes in our proprioception, in our visual cues, hearing abilities, and vestibular systems, which really increases our risk for falls. The inputs come from the periphery, the muscles, the joints, the skin sensations, which relate to the brain. Brain integrates all this information along with inputs from the eyes and the ears, and then directs our muscles and limbs and joints as to how we should be walking and what kind of action we should be taking. So somehow this simple test gives us both a qualitative and quantitative information on the risk factor the person may have. This correlates very well with the activities of daily living. So we ask a person to stand up, walk feet, turn around, walk back, and sit down. And one has to notice the use of hands, the sway, the stagger, the unsteadiness, the use of hands while sitting down. A normal person can complete this in 10 seconds, a healthy older person. But there's a big range, you know. One shouldn't be carried away by the time factor, because this range from 7 seconds to about 17 seconds, it does increase with age, and the women take longer to complete this simple test. But it has a pretty good sensitivity and specificity. And I'll show you two simple video clips for which I acknowledge the authors who have supplied us with those clips. One is a normal timed up-and-go test, and then followed by an abnormal test, and you'll see the differences. If you have see those things in your patients, then interventions in the form of physical therapy and occupational therapy and other evidence-based interventions should be put in place. Look at the first normal timed up-and-go test.
Lower extremity function is tested using what is commonly termed the get up and go test. The basic elements of this test are conducted by asking the patient to rise from the chair without using his arms. He should then walk as quickly as possible 10 feet from the chair, turn around, and return and sit back down. This is a get-up-and-go test. Watch how he stands. Note that his gait is both narrow-based and wide-based at times. At his turn, he has mild loss of balance. On the return, you can see that his hips are not level. He also has difficulty getting down to the low height of the chair. After raising up his seat, he gets up more easily, but he still uses his hands. On the third attempt, he gets up without using his hands, but does use a compensatory technique. Compare his time to the other two videos.
Moving on, after this video clips, I apologize if there's some tech glitches. I hope everybody is able to hear me now. The other test, simple test, is a functional reach test. And this is another simple test which just will need a dollar for somebody to buy a yardstick. And this measures patient's forward reach. One can put this yardstick on a tripod and also measure a lateral balance or sideways reach. Basically, one stands on the side of a wall and extends his arms at 90 degrees of shoulder flexion while upright and lean forward. And if somebody cannot reach or does less than 6 inches, the studies have shown that these patients will be at risk for falls in the future, most likely in the next 6-12 months. But if somebody can do 6 inches, then they are in good shape. A figure show how it is done. If you look at the base, one doesn't have to move their feet, and you start at one point and measure the distance in inches, and then move forward and record the difference. So that's your functional reach test. basically forward reach test. Then Romberg's test is another good simple test which really differentiates. It's a key test which differentiates proprioception issues coming from the periphery versus those coming from the central nervous system. This really differentiates sensory ataxia from cerebral ataxia. And this can be tested. You just have to ask the patient to stand and close their eyes, but make there are at least a couple of people around the person, because this can itself cause or result in fall. So one has to be careful when doing this test. One doesn't have to really push the chest or do the nudge. Really, if Romberg's is positive, then the moment the person closes their eyes, they will be falling or will be at risk for falling. But you can actually test the limits of balance by actually putting patients' feet in a semi-tandem and tandem stance, because normally what happens with aging, when we stand, our feet, the distance between the 2 feet is about 6 inches. With aging, that the distance is a bit more, increases. So what happens is, the moment you ask the person to put feet together, you are bringing this instability. So it's, I think it's best to check the patient's Romberg's in their normal stance, what they do, and then, of course, bring the feet together to check how stable or unstable they are. And, of course, this is furthering the challenge, and it's called this sharpened Romberg's. Single leg stance is another great test. So we talked about timed up and go, the functional reach, the Romberg's, the single leg stance. This is a very difficult test to do. And if you have your 80 years plus population, try and ask them to do it. And believe me, they will not be able to do it. Because if somebody can stand on one leg for 10 seconds, there are usually no significant balance problems. And so it's a great test, but again, the risk for falling while doing it. And probably perhaps many of the interventions we have, like Tai Chi and other yoga, have really, you know, are training the mind and your proprioception and reflexes to improve your balance this way. Certainly, one can improve with exercise and interventions. So single leg was a hard test to do. What we had is a modified single leg stance. In some of the work we've done here in Cincinnati, actually, in many, even if the patient is using walker and have difficulty in walking, or sometimes have to use wheelchairs, even the frailest patients have done studies in assisted living are able to do this test. If they can hold on to some table or back of a chair or something, they're able to stand on one leg. So if more and more people can do this test, then it becomes a great intervention tool in terms of exercises. In fact, what I tell my patients, that they shouldn't be sitting and watching television. In fact, they can just stand and hold the back of the sofa and maybe stand on one leg or march in one place to improve the tone in the muscles and improve their balance and riding reflexes. So that's another good test to use. In fact, it's a good intervention, because a patient is at less risk for falls. Sorry, this is a busy slide, but this is really an approach you can have in practice. There's some materials I've given in the handouts. Please refer to those as well. It's got a lot of good tools there. Basically, this patient's history physical examination should include a get-up-and-go test, and then see what kind of issues come up on this evaluation, whether it's a weakness problem when patient is trying to use their hands to get out of chair, or they're using their hands to sit down, or they're swaying and they have they're staggering, or they have difficulty when they're turning. That points more towards balance problem. And of course, a full review of the medications a person may be taking. And this is the list which I've already mentioned before. And then partial hypertension. You know, it's critical to assess partial hypertension, and that is at 1 minute and 3 minutes in order to be certain the patient doesn't have orthostasis. And the drop of 20 millimeters of mercury in the systolic with or without rise in heart rate is really significant. So depending on the problems identified, one could link them up with a physical therapist, do resistance training and sets, or an occupational therapist who can work on balance training, look at some of the things which can really make a difference. Looking at the shoes, we want a shoe with a broad kind of contact surface area. Cane and walker can increase your base of support from 6 inches to 18 and, inches and more. These are the things which can really make a difference. If they have cataracts, you know, removing cataracts might help, and of course giving them their hearing aid. Medications basically follow 3 rules. Either you stop them, or you reduce the dose, or you basically give something safer. And of course, if they have orthostatic hypertension, one of the common problems in the elderly because of autonomic problems, we have postprandial hypertension after big meals. So hydration is important, salt intake, so they should be on a normal diet, no special diets for older population who have risk for falls, and also kind of giving them stockings, the compression stockings, and also caffeine intake. Those people who have the postprandial hypertension will benefit from caffeine or coffee with each meal. And of course, some of the medications can be used. And for everyone, as I mentioned, and it will be touched more in detail by Rochelle, is environmental safety and home occupational therapy and safety assessment. And everyone should have osteoporosis prevention, calcium, and vitamin D has been shown to be really helpful in reducing falls on the basis of the data and analysis, some of the meta-analysis and research review we know so far. We need at least 800 to 1,000 international units of vitamin D every day, and vitamin D level testing is maybe worthwhile. So I just talked about falls so far, and it's just all the factors related to it. But for injury, including fracture and head injury prevention, really one has to look at the forces which cause these issues, and then, of course, the bone health, and that's where the prevention comes in. So in terms of prevention, of course, I mentioned calcium and vitamin D, but there are other approaches which can be used, including exercise, which my co-presenter will go in more detail. Exercise of any form is good in fall prevention and rehabilitation. Hip protectors have been around for a while now, but we don't have a clear direction as to whom we should prescribe these. The data and the evidence has been mixed so far. Compliance is an issue. Design of the hip protectors is also being discussed. There are cost issues, but it may be worth considering in high-risk individuals. And I think some nursing home and some insurance plan are covering these hip protectors. This is the basic idea. There's a shield, you know, some have plastic insert or other material. Others have foam padding. The basic idea is it covers the greater trochanter. The logic is your forces on falling are transmitted by this narrow neck of femur, and if you can displace some of the forces, when somebody hits a greater trochanter, then we may be able to prevent this hip fractures occurring. But I think we need to really have more evidence and more experience with these hip protectors. But it may be worthwhile using in patients who are at risk and those who can afford. This is what the hip protectors look like. in terms of the padding, the side padding, and this one has a tail bone protection as well. I'm near the end of my present time here. I just want to mention these things which have come out from our clinical practice evidence-based guidelines. Basically, one has to minimize medications, and education and review of medication with dose reduction and cessation is critical to the success of any preventive efforts and reducing falls in the future. Then we have to have an individually tailored exercise program. All aspects of gait training, balance, and strengthening are important, and you'll hear more of that in part two. Vision impairment is important. It has been shown that if one has cataract surgery, at least removal of the first cataract has been shown to decrease the rate of falls. I'm not sure about removing the second one, but it does make sense. Then managing partial hypertension on lines I mentioned before, diagnosing it correctly, and then working on hydration, normal food intake, salt intake, small meals, and using some medications to address, or stopping some medication which cause partial hypertension and dehydration, like diuretics and antihypertensive. Then, of course, in the literature, we have carotid sinus hypersensitivity, which has been reported. And so some assessment of cardiac causes is also important if the history points in the direction. In fact, in series from Great Britain, it has been shown that if these patients who usually have some autonomic problem are able to get a pacemaker, then they have been shown to reduce the falls. Then we have the vitamin D supplements, as I mentioned before, have been shown to decrease the falls. We don't know the exact mechanism, but perhaps it's good for bones and muscles, and also certainly it may decrease body sway and reduce fractures. Then we have the footwear problems. One should have a shoe, a usual tennis or athletic type shoes with a high contact surface area may help in reducing falls. Walking bare feet has been shown to increase falls, and similarly high heels and decreased surface area shoes will increase falls. Then, of course, home modification of home environment is very important, and you'll hear more of that in part two of the presentation. The lights, you need bright lights, you need the right height of bed and chairs, the rails, the flooring, all has to be removal of clutters, which will help reduce chances of falling. And of course, education and information on home hazards, exercise, benefits of exercise, and choices for footwear. So this is really the main factors which have been, and the intention which have been shown to work on the basis of literature so far. So in summary, falls are a significant cause of morbidity and mortality. Falls in the elderly are multifactorial, and individualized, multidisciplinary, multi-component, multifactorial interventions approaches provide the best evidence for prevention and management. So that's all I have to say right now, and we'll come back and take your questions and answer them together towards the end, and pass it on to Rochelle. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Modawal. That was very wonderfully detailed, and I'll do my best to add to what you have shared. And thank you all for connecting with us today on this very important topic. So I'm going to start by focusing a bit on the community-based and in-home fall prevention, since that's what I do for Farewell to Falls. And there is going to be some redundancy, but I will zip through anything that Dr. Modawal already went into detail on, which is fantastic. So for community-based fall prevention, I'm talking about aging and adult community center programs, which are wonderful because they're able to reach older adults that may not have access to knowledge about fall prevention otherwise. They are able to reach larger number of older adults. They generally are in a lecture format or possibly in a group facilitated format, which is fantastic. And it does provide a sense of community and group participation, which can be very helpful for a lot of older adults that need social support. However, follow-through can be a challenge because they're not in the home, and so they're not able to make real specific recommendations. So in the in-home fall prevention program, I'm able to observe the individual, obviously, in their home environment.
Yes.
Okay, great. Sorry about that. Okay, so we're able to practice the learned skills in real time in a functional, meaningful way. For example, the entire time until just now is the crazy thing. Okay, can everybody hear me now? So there may be also more compliance with the programs that are taught in the individual's home because I'm able to just individualize the exercises where I want the exercises to be done. So let's move on here from there. So as far as the assessment, because this is a hospital-based program, there are consent forms for the individual to sign. The individual does not need to have had a fall. We do look at the general medical history, which Dr. Modawal went into detail on. We also look at the medications, and we also do a fall risk assessment, which Dr. Modawal also went into detail on, which was wonderful. And then the home assessments. We're going to go in more detail on the home assessment. So we look, again, just briefly, I'll skim through this. Date of most recent fall, the number of falls in the past year. How did they describe the fall? Where was the fall? Was medical treatment needed? And is there a fear of falling? Oftentimes, after someone's had a major fall, that fear that they have of having another fall limits them pretty significantly. And then their balance is reduced, their strength is reduced. So it's important to know that. And obviously, assistive devices. We do a health interview, and we want to highlight any areas that may increase the risk for falling, physiologically, cognitive, and psychologically. So we also look at activities of daily living and try to identify a baseline level of functioning. Are they able to tolerate the basic activities of daily living? And what is their exercise tolerance? So something we might ask is how often they actually leave their house to run errands, go to doctor's appointments and things like that. Someone that says that they leave their house every day is generally less likely to or be at a lower risk for falling than someone who says that they don't leave their house very often. So we also do a medication review. It's a very detailed review of the medications, and we send that to the pharmacy staff at Stanford. And they generate a report, so then on the second visit when I see the individuals, I have this report, and it helps to highlight the common side effects of, most medications have, and they may include dizziness and lightheadedness, nausea, fatigue, weakness, and some can even affect their electrolyte balance. And oftentimes they don't realize that the side effects of the medications increase their risk for falling. There's one particular medication that we've had some success with in trying to reduce, as OTs, we don't obviously reduce the medications. What we're asking them to do, for example, is to take their blood pressure daily, if by getting, one of the blood pressure cuffs from the drugstore and have them keep a journal of their blood pressure. If they can, if they show that their blood pressure is in either within normal limits or oftentimes it's even low, then they'll have that journal with them to take to their next doctor's appointment, and they can have a dialogue with their doctor about, you know, here I am on these, you know, sometimes they're on multiple blood pressure medications to reduce their blood pressure, and their blood pressure is either normal to low. And so they can ask the physician to see if they can start to slowly reduce the level of the medication, and in some cases be completely removed from the medication. Oftentimes people are put on a certain level of medication, they've been on it for, you know, 15, 20 years, but as an older adult, maybe there's less stress in their life, maybe they're just more sensitive to certain medications because their bodies do change over the years. And there has been some success to help people start to reduce some of these heavy-duty medications that can really increase their risk for falling. So again, we do the gait test and the balance test. Dr. Modawal went into wonderful detail on that. One thing I do want to say about that is that we use those tests as an education tool. So just like the great videos that were shown, if somebody, let's say they're shuffling their feet, so as soon as they've done that, they've walked the 10 feet and they come back, I'll say, now did you notice the sound, did you hear the sound of that you were shuffling your feet? Or I'll say, did you notice that you lost your balance there a bit? So it allows us to highlight that they have impairments in their balance, and just to give them more awareness, a greater awareness of their risk. We do score the test so that at the end, if it says they are at a high risk for falling, I really try to make that clear to them, not, you know, to induce fear, but to just help them increase the awareness of the fact that they need to take extra care and also to incorporate the exercises, which we'll be talking about in a moment. So for the intervention, we're going to talk about mindfulness and fall prevention, how I incorporate that, the home recommendations. We're not going to go in detail of the medication review, exercise education, and Dr. Modawa also touched on nutrition and hydration education as appropriate. So mindfulness and fall prevention. As Dr. Modawal mentioned, there are lots of handouts for you, and one of them in particular is the balance assessment that we do in the fall prevention program, the Farewell to Falls program. One of the tests is an advanced balance test, and what we have them do is walk the 10 feet while turning their head at an established pace. And we use a metronome to have them turn their head about 30 degrees in each direction at 100 beats per minute. Most older adults, this is challenging, and what it does show them is that their dynamic balance is reduced. And so this is sort of my segue into having them practice this mindfulness, which is the first one says, and the handout is also in, this is in more detail in your handout, to pause when they're changing position. So if they're going from a lying down to sitting position, to pause and to use this acronym for those, again, that like acronyms, STOP, which is the S is to stop, T is to take a breath, and then the O is to observe. What they're observing is how their body is feeling in the moment. So is there pain or weakness? Do they feel lightheaded or dizzy? And then proceed. So the observation gives them a chance to do certain things, like let's say they are feeling dizzy, to take a few deep breaths, or to maybe pump their feet and ankles before standing up to get the blood out of their legs and to engage the blood so it's up into their brain before they stand up. So it gives them a pause, basically, anytime they're changing position, especially from sitting to standing, they're about to walk. The mindfulness also helps to establish greater awareness of their body sensations. So when they are walking, they pay attention to if they are feeling weakness or if they are feeling dizzy or whatever. And then awareness of sensation of breath. If what we're finding is that if someone is lost in thought, that can be just as distracting as if someone's trying to do two things at once. So the breath, because it exists in the present moment, when you take a deep breath in, it brings their awareness into their into the present moment while they're walking. It does require that they have to slow down, which is valuable in preventing falls. And we also ask that they learn to pay attention to the task at hand. So, for example, while walking, pay attention to the act of walking. Try to focus only on the walking. Our minds are easily distracted, which can increase the risk or potential for falling. So for the home safety assessment, we look at their entrances, so, getting in and out of their home. Sometimes people never even go out their front door, so where are they coming in and out of their home? It might be the garage. I had one gentleman who had a very narrow stairwell all the way down into his garage. There's a cement floor, and he did have one very thin railing on one side, but it didn't extend to the end of the steps. So there were two steps that didn't have a railing, and he fell at that point. Luckily, he didn't break anything, but it was certainly enough of a wake-up call to, he put railings on both sides. They extended all the way down into the bottom of the steps in the garage, making sure, and it was dim, so the lighting wasn't adequate. So he had that adjusted. And then obviously surfaces. Just this week I had one woman who's lived in her house for many, many years and has never changed the carpeting. And then there's holes in the, different parts of the carpeting. You could easily get your foot caught in there. Another aspect of floors, one dangerous thing is to have a rug, like an area rug, on top of a carpet. And people are often very attached to their rugs sometimes, and I know what they're doing is they want to keep their rug clean, but there are times where I'll even say, it's much less expensive to have your rugs cleaned once a year than to have a fall and have a hip fracture. The emotional and physical cost of having a fractured hip is much greater than cleaning your rugs once a year. Okay, so certainly looking out for clutter, and if there's cords, if they're adamant about not removing a particular rug, asking them to have it stapled down. Let's see, and then as far as the shower and the tub, if someone could afford one grab bar, the best grab bar would be for stepping into and out of the tub. So on the photo here, you can see one grab bar. This is basically a roll-in shower, but many of our older adults in their homes have a standard tub where they have to step over. So having the grab bar on the side in a vertical position for them to hang on is the most valuable. And then obviously having non-slip mats. I have two pictures. There's a tub here and then a little shower stall. This particular mat can be purchased online. The website is called noslipgatorgrip.com. It's N-O-S-L-I-P, and then it's gator, like alligator, gator skin, gatorgrip.com. And you do have a copy of the PowerPoint presentation in the handout, so you'll have all of that. And we also check for outlets. I have people that have 3, 4, and 5 things plugged into one particular outlet, and it's sitting right over the sink and can be a very dangerous situation. In the bedroom, we recommend having a lamp next to the bed and a phone within reach of the bed. It's something that a lot of older adults don't think about, but I do tell them if there's ever a chance that you wake up in the middle of the night and you can't move, or you may not even be able to remember a phone number. So we ask them to have you know, phone numbers next to the bed. Also, sometimes people have speed dial on the phone, but still having at least one, you know, significant phone number next to the bed is important for their safety. For the kitchen, a safe step stool is really important. And again, there's two pictures here of two step stools that are probably the safest. The best is to not even have two steps. For some reason, the moment older adults go up two steps, it's very disorienting. They don't realize they've gone up two steps. They forget. And then they fall when they're coming back down. We also want to make sure the refrigerator opens easily. We've had people that are just yanking on the refrigerator. Their hand is weakened, and it slides off. They fall back and hit their head. And also having non-slip mats, but having ones that are thin rubber, or not just, doesn't have to be rubber, but just a thin mat so there's nothing for their feet to get caught on. Dr. Modawal went over the shoes. And obviously railings to run the full length of stairs, ideally on both sides, and that they're well lighted. I said that about emergency phone numbers. And the Vial of Life is a system, community system, and most communities have this now, where if emergency medical technicians come into the home, they will look at the refrigerator, and if they see the sticker, you'll see that little medicine bottle, it says Vial of Life. If they see a sticker on the front of the refrigerator that says Vial of Life, they know that the person has this medicine bottle filled out with their basic medical information on the door, on the inside door of the refrigerator. And so if the EMT people come, they will grab the vial and they will grab the older adult and they will go. They won't waste any time trying to figure out where to go, where to take them, what medications they're on, etc. And then Lifeline, if an older adult is left alone for any significant period of time, and it depends on the person, but sometimes even 2 hours if somebody is, you know, is at really high risk for falling. But to have a system such as Lifeline, or there's others, one's called Life Alert, where they have, there's a picture here also, they can wear a button around their neck, so if they fall, they can push a button, and it will call 911, or you can set it up so it calls, you know, a caregiver or a loved one to call you back to see what's happened or to come over, so you can set it up either way. So as far as exercise recommendations, for our program, we need a physician referral it's required for us to talk to participants about exercises. And we say that there are five different types of exercises that help us reduce the risk for falling. This is all evidence-based. So obviously strength and balance, flexibility, endurance, and then walking. Most of our older adults do some sort of walking. We do say, though, that walking is great. It's just very linear, so we're not getting that balance component that we so need. So I want to just let you know that these pictures were taken from the National Institutes of Health website, and I have the resource at the end of this page. And I want to highlight one in particular on this page, and it's to the bottom left where the gentleman is doing a sit-to-stand exercise. Our program we're just having a dialogue about trying to increase compliance with exercises. It's just a really difficult thing to get our older adults to exercise. And so we're trying a new approach, which is to simplify. And I'll tell you these four different exercises towards the end after we go through these, just so you have all of these in case you needed them. But one of the four, is the sit-to-stand exercise. And then here's some balance exercises, and I just want to show you the one again at the bottom left. I just want to tell you what she's doing, and it's basically just closing her eyes. She's holding on to a surface, and then to challenge herself is, you know, bringing her hands off the chair. She could be doing this in a regular supported, you know, her stance, you know, her feet are about hip width apart. But we could also ask them to increase their challenge by bringing their feet together, but holding on. Okay. And some flexibility exercises. I also tell people that their daily life is their informal exercise. That these formal exercises are critical also for fall prevention, but I do want people to know that if they're doing their daily life in, you know, with awareness, like they're holding their posture tall and they're using good body mechanics, that even getting dressed in the morning is great movement for their body. And I also ask them if they are trying to get on and if do they get on and off the floor every day. Some of our older adults are able to do that and feel safe doing that as long as somebody is home. And so I encourage them to do that because it helps to reduce some fear, knowing that they would be able to get themselves back up off the floor if they can get down. And I also, it's all that movement to get down off the floor and come back up is an excellent exercise in and of itself. And then endurance. We, in our program, we do supply the, I'm forgetting the name of these, but counting, it's this little device that helps you count your steps. And for some of our older adults that are a little bit more active and are interested in doing that, but it helps to provide some motivation to increase their endurance. So the big four exercises, we are going to give this a try, and these exercises came out of the University of San Francisco. The resource again is at the end of this presentation. Dr. Christian Thompson has done some peer-reviewed research on these particular exercises and has found that they have reduced the risk of falling in a number of older adults. So the first one is ankle circles, and we are having people really exaggerate the ankle circle and to do it in both directions and also to do it until they start to feel fatigued. And for everyone, that's going to be a little bit different. We ask them, because there's these four exercises, we ask them to do it maybe more times throughout the day, if they remember, and also to spend a little bit more time on each exercise. Now, the Tada exercise is it's basically you're standing, you do a squat, and you take your right hand and touch the outside of your left leg, and then you rotate, bringing the right arm all the way up, and like you're doing a Tada with the right hand up, and you're looking up at the hand, and then you do the other side with the left hand. So it's basically a squat and rotate. And then the side step is an exaggerated side step. It's almost like marching, but you're stepping to the side. And you go in both directions. And then there's the sit-to-stand exercise, which we had a picture of previously. So we also do a follow-up for our program, which is really important in trying to gain compliance with the exercises, making sure that people are following through on the recommendations, as far as non-slip mats in the tub and picking up rugs off the floor, installing grab bars or railings, fixing lighting, things like that. So we have participants, we have some volunteers that call our participants every 2 weeks or so to answer their questions if they have any about the exercises, provide some motivation for the exercises. And we do give them a calendar that for them to fill out on a weekly basis about which exercises they're doing on a daily basis so that when our volunteers call that they can recall what exercises they've done over the past few weeks. And then we do a one-year follow-up visit where we redo the balance and gait reassessment. And I tell them that I'll be coming in a year and I tell them why, and the idea is that with the home modification recommendations and if they're participating in the exercises, we will likely show that they will reduce their risk for falling, as well as, the medication reductions if it's possible for them. And we also go over any interventions that may need to be highlighted. So here are a few resources. Again, this presentation is in your handouts along with many other of the documents that we use in Farewell to Falls. And I will open it up to questions.
Thank you, Dr. Modawal and Ms. McLaughlin. We now have some time for the presenters to answer your questions. If you have any questions, please use the chat feature. It is located on the left side of your screen. After the Q&A, we would like to ask each of the participants to answer the short evaluation questionnaire you will find on the last slide. We will now turn to the questions the participants have asked.
There's a question, maybe I'll take that one, is why are women at higher risk for falls? Well, that's a good question. You know, it has come out on the stats. Hello, can everybody hear me? I was talking about why women at higher risk for falls. Basically, it has come out in the studies, you know, one is the gender, the other is the age. For every decade increase in age, your risk for falls increases by a certain percentage. So, in terms of causes, I don't know. It's just that's what's been shown in some studies. But it could be that women have more osteoporosis, and they have more kyphoid scoliosis sometimes, and that is causing some flexion, change in the posture, and altering the center of gravity. Or is it just a shoe wear? I don't know. So it's just one of the things which has come up. You know, maybe they're wearing heels. So heels is not a good idea. So I see a lot of requests for the handouts. Let me tell you, these will be sent copy of slides by email. Also, if you go to pogoe.org, some of the materials which I have shown you are also displayed on the website of pogoe.org. That's a portal for online geriatric education. POGOE.ORG.
Dr. Modawal, there's one question about the best type of shoe to wear, and what we recommend is a shoe that's like a kid. It's a thin rubber sole so that the older adult can really feel where their foot is in space. If they're in a really thick rubber sole, it reduces their sense for where their foot is in space. If they're on a small pebble or on, you know, an acorn or something like that, they're less likely to feel something like that and could, you know, turn their ankle. But just a thin rubber sole.
Yeah, may I add to that is I think the thin is fine, but you need some firmness as well. And also anything, mm-hmm. you know, which has a high contact surface areas, as you mentioned, no high heels. The other thing which has been shown to reduce is, especially during icy conditions for folks living, is a non-slip shoe covering has been shown to reduce falls. But yeah, I agree with that. You know, thin rubber soles like you have in a tennis shoe would be good. The other thing about shoes is the traction. You know, you don't want those crepe-like soles as well, which almost like stick to your floors as well, which may itself sometimes cause increase in falls. So you have to have these flat shoes, rubber soles, thin, firm, broad base, which are not kind of have a lot of friction between, which generate a lot of friction between the feet and the floorings. Is, do you have any?
Go ahead. Did you want to say anything about that?
There was another question here. Do you have any information on energy conservation, shortness of breath, and falls? I think that ties into, Rochelle, you may want to answer, is mindfulness of fall prevention. Like, one has to remain focused on the task, you know. There is a test in the literature called a talk and walk test. You know, you cannot do two functions at the same time. And I think that may be a reflection of your multitasking abilities, which diminish with age, or your cardiorespiratory health status. And those have been shown to increase the risk of falls. If your walk and talk test is abnormal, that means you cannot talk while walking. That means, you know, you get into some kind of exercise program.
Mm-hmm. I'll touch on, there's a question about, are there issues that are different for falls in different ethnic populations? I found that it's very universal, you know, across ethnic populations, that everybody really could use more fall prevention knowledge about how to prevent falls. There's, you know, some very, they might be small aspects of this with populations that take off their shoes when they go into their house. And sometimes what I've recommended, like Dr. Modawal mentioned, that bare feet have shown to increase the risk for falling. And so I've suggested for those people to have a house shoe that's, you know, just as supportive and, you know, no heels. Sometimes there's like house slippers that actually have a bit of a heel on it, but something like a thin rubber sole for in the home. Have you noticed anything that might be different, Dr. Modawal,
yeah,
as far as
I think ethnic population, basically, I think some ethnic groups do not like to wear shoes and socks inside their homes. And I think there have been some evidence that if you're walking bare feet, then you have basically less of contact with the flooring, and with a broad shoe or slipper, which is stable. And slippers have been known to increase falls. Any kind of shoe which can increase your contact surface area might help. One should not wear just socks. You know, that's another thing. And even socks with the grips and all, really, the way they're worn and the way they're used, you know, can increase the risk for falls. So in terms of ethnicity, I think the risk factors are the same. In terms of fracture and injury prevention, certain ethnic groups may do certain activities, particularly the elderly population, which may increase the risk. In terms of bone health, there are issues like Asian and Caucasian white population have more osteoporosis and more prone to risk of falling and breaking compared to the African American or black population. They have healthier bones and less risk for osteoporosis. Tied to that is the vitamin D levels in the blood and exposure to sun. I think people who are dark skin need more exposure to sunlight to produce the same amount of vitamin D in the body compared to a fair skin population. And I think there are cultural factors about sun exposure and sitting out in the sun which may lead to less of vitamin D in certain, you know, Asian groups or some other ethnicities, and certainly that needs to be kept in mind in terms of the bone health and vitamin D levels. Otherwise, the general risk factors would be very similar. There's no differences racial or on ethnic lines. There was another comment which add to my answering the question about women, is that women live actually longer than men, and there are more women in the higher age groups in 80 and 90 plus, and that may also be creating some kind of statistical artifact where this gender has been shown to have greater prevalence of falls in women. That's a good point too. Mm-hmm. There's a question on Tai Chi as a prevention strategy again for falls. Again, yeah, Tai Chi has been shown. In fact, it's one of the exercise programs which has been well studied And certainly, as part of the exercise, it is certainly worth using if you have access to, because it combines both a strengthening and balanced measure and increases your aerobic capacity as well. It's been shown to reduce the risk of falls among community dwellers. There's a lot of literature on Tai Chi and falls. Rochelle, you want to add to exercise and Tai Chi?
Yes. Well, Tai Chi, you know, I'm often surprised by how many of our older adults in the community do Tai Chi. It's wonderful to see that, because it really is, it touches on the movement of the body that we wouldn't get normally in our daily life, and it's all about balance, increasing our balance, and also our endurance. It's certainly an exercise for endurance as well, so it's a great all-around activity and exercise for our older ones to do. It's gentle, and it can be modified, so someone can have a chair right near them if they need to use it as support. So it's a wonderful exercise.
Talking about ethnic factors, again, one of the things we mentioned about medications use, and I think one has to look at the over-the-counter medications, including many of the herbal preparations, which may increase the risk of falls or may interact with many of the medications, the traditional Western medications the person may be taking. So one has to have a good feel of all the things the person is doing, including over-the-counter and herbal products person may be taking, which may increase the risk of falls. I do not know any specific over-the-counter or herbal products which may increase the risk of falls in terms of herbal preparations, but certainly any central nervous system acting over-the-counter products should be suspect. People are using aids for sleeping, aids for depression, and any other neuropsychiatric anxiety. I think all those things should be considered. Also, talking about over-the-counter products, there's also a perception in certain population that just because it's over-the-counter is safer. In fact, it's just the opposite. These patients are very high in anticholinergic activities. And related to the ethnicity is the issues of access to health. If these certain populations, and we have a lot of them in millions in the United States, who do not have access to proper health care or access to a physician, they may rely on some of these over-the-counter products available for many of the common ailments. For example, anti-allergic medications, you know, they are full of anticholinergic side effects. Drugs like Tylenol PM with the Benadryl part or diphenhydramine, people are using for sleeping and other ailments. These are all increasing the side effects of these anticholinergic side effect profile and increasing the risk of falls. Allergy medications, anti-diarrheal medications, you know, cough and cold mixtures, all those have very high antihistaminics. These are all could be potentially very toxic drugs in the elderly. And I really don't, if I see patients with cough and cold, and do not give them any of these products. In fact, they're taking on their own. In fact, I possibly ask them to stop it. Tylenol PM and Aleve PM and some of the other over-the-counter products, because of the diphenhydramine and Benadryl component, has very high anticholinergic activity. So one has to be very cautious. There's a question about other medication, about educational tools. where can I find? I think you have the resources from the CDC, and I think at the end of the handouts and presentations, if you read the handouts, it has got a lot of resources in the article in JAMA from Trinity. At the end of it, there are a lot of websites where one can go to. Here in Hamilton County, in Cincinnati, we have a Hamilton County Falls Prevention Task Force. Their website has a lot of easy-to-read material for the community in general and for older adults. There is a question on SSRI. Well, as I mentioned, all the CNS-acting medications are associated with increased risk of falls, including the SSRIs. So there's always a benefit and risk equation to prescribing any medications. People live in fear of falling after a fall. They have a lot of anxiety. It's like almost like a post-traumatic stress problem. And many people really give up walking because they're so scared and they're living in fear. And certainly where these antidepressants and anti-anxiety medications can help, but, you know, one has to weigh the risk. But the general dictum for the old population is that we start slow and start low. So we give the smallest possible medication and monitor the progress and look for any side effects. But keep going, because sometimes these patients are depressed and may need higher dose than is higher dose to still help with their depression and anxiety. So it's all, you know, it's a trade-off, and one has to look at the balance of risk and benefits and mobility restriction or allow them. I think one should always encourage older persons to be to keep the mobility, and if you can't fix the problem of falls, then we have alternatives of wheelchairs and motorized scooters and all, which are okay as long as they are able to maintain independence and have a reasonable quality of life. I think we should use all the assistive devices available to us in order to improve function, mobility, and independence. That's the bottom line. Knowing sometimes we do not have easy solution to the problems these older persons face. I think we have used the time. Are there any other questions or final comments? Back to Chris.
Thank you, Dr. Modawal. It was wonderful presenting with you.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure, Rochelle, and good luck with your project. I'll be interested to know more about it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, both Dr. Modawal and McLaughlin. This is Chris Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on falls, gait, and balance disorders in older adults. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey allows us to continue to get funding. Also, everybody was asking, a lot of people were asking about the handouts, so I put a little link to the handouts on the left if you wanted to get them, and they will also be available on the website, the SGEC website, in the very near future. Our next webinar in the series will be on Thursday, May 26th at the same time. It will be on emergency preparedness and elder care and presented by Charles A. Cefalu, M.D., Mellon R. McBride, Ph.D., Arlene Johnson, Ph.D., and Elizabeth M. Shields, Ph.D. Thank you for coming and hope to see you next time.